I always love that when I come forward and people rush back to their pews. Good morning. It is Good Shepherd Sunday. The fourth Sunday of Easter is typically Good Shepherd Sunday. And so that means throughout the hymns and the lessons and even the psalm today, we're going to focus on Jesus being our Good Shepherd. And it's not always a comforting thing to think of yourself as a sheep. In fact, I think there's a phrase out there that I think they're even calling it right now about things about COVID, right? They're calling people sheeple. There's this bad connotation with sheep that we just follow whomever leads us and we're just going to do what they say. We as sheep in the Bible, God calls believers sheep because we do need a leader. And the only leader that we need is him and him alone. And so today, we worship the Good Shepherd who laid down his life for us. He is the true leader and will never guide us or lead us astray. And so that is who we worship today with all our hymns and readings. Before we begin our worship, though, we're going to start with the Wells Connection as we see and are connected with the rest of our church body here and worldwide. We'll now watch that.
Hi, I'm Wells President Mark Schrader. 60 years ago, when our synod began work in Africa, our missionaries faced a challenge. It was extremely difficult to build those first relationships with the African people. The cultural differences were large, and the Africans were wary of newcomers. We needed to find a way to show our Christian love and build trust.
Today, the Lutheran churches in Malawi and Zambia are the largest in our fellowship, with more than 50,000 members. But it wasn't always like this. In the early days, it was slow going. But then, God opened doors through the blessing of this, a medical team of Wells members, funded and sent by Wells World Missions, called the Central Africa Medical Mission, which began work here in 1960. When the African people saw that we loved them enough to offer much-needed medical care, hearts began to open to the gospel of Christ.
When they brought in the first medical assistance, all of a sudden everybody was paying attention, and the Lord has blessed it tremendously.
For many decades now, World Missions has sent the Central Africa Medical Mission to work in tandem with our missionaries and the national churches.
Not only are we taking care of 60,000 people, but we are changing lives one person at a time, and it is so awesome to see.
The medical mission has regular clinic days at our churches and other locations, and also operates a mobile clinic that travels to remote villages. Much of the work focuses on mothers and children under age 5, who especially need health care.
We really have an emphasis on primary health care, which is preventive health care, especially for under 5 children, making sure they get their immunizations and their vitamins and checkups. And they know we are there because we are Christians and we want to serve them with the love of Christ.
The Central Africa Medical Mission serves more than 1,000 people each week in their clinics, funded solely through donations from individuals.
So what that means, if you run the math, is that we provide services for around $5 per patient, which is remarkable value.
The medical mission now has 30 workers total, serving in Zambia and Malawi. Over time, more and more Africans have been trained as medical staff.
We don't know where the Lord is going to take us, but we are excited to find out because we know there's so much more work for us to do.
While we don't know our Savior's plans for the future, we do know that for 60 years, He has used this medical mission as a way to build relationships and grow His church in Africa.
The blessing of the Central Africa Medical Mission has led to plans to expand this ministry model to other regions around the world. With American volunteers helping our missionaries by providing much needed medical care and opportunities to share the good news of Jesus. And during this Easter season, as we celebrate our Savior's victorious resurrection from the dead, on behalf of all of us who work with you and for you at the Synod, may you have a very blessed and joyful Easter.
As I mentioned earlier, this is the fourth Sunday of Easter, which is also Good Shepherd Sunday. And to guide us through our worship this morning, we'll follow the order of morning praise found on page 45 in Christian Worship, if you'd like to follow there, or on the following slides. And we're going to open with our opening hymn, hymn 375, "The King of Love, My Shepherd Is." May the Lord bless our worship. Please stand. We'll join in these song responses.
O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall declare your praise. Hasten to save me, O God. The Lord is risen, let us worship him.
We'll join in the next three verses of "The King of Love, My Shepherd Is."
Cross before.
We now turn to our first lesson for today from the book of Acts, chapter 20, verses 28 through 32. It's also found on page 1585 if you'd like to follow on your pew Bibles. Luke writes, "Keep watch over yourselves and all the flock of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Be shepherds of the church of God, which he bought with his own blood. I know that after I leave, savage wolves will come in among you and will not spare the flock. Even from your own number, men will arise and distort the truth in order to draw away disciples after them. So be on your guard. Remember that for 3 years I never stopped warning each of you night and day with tears. Now I commit you to God and to the word of his grace, which can build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. This is the word of God." We'll now join in the psalm of the day, Psalm 23, found on page 72 in the front of your hymnals or on the following slides. We'll sing the psalm together.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures, he leads me beside quiet.
Now turn our attention to our second lesson for today from 1 Peter chapter 5, the first four verses. If you'd like to follow along your pew Bibles, it's on page 1731. More descriptions on what it is to be a shepherd of God's flock. "To the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder and a witness of Christ's sufferings, who also will share in the glory to be revealed. Be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, watching over them. Not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be, not pursuing dishonest gain, but eager to serve, not lording it over those who entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. This is the word of the Lord." The Lord has risen. The Lord has risen indeed. Alleluia. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Alleluia. Please now stand out of respect for the words and works of our Savior. The gospel for this Good Shepherd Sunday is recorded in John chapter 10, verses 11 through 18. It's also called the Good Shepherd chapter. If you'd like to follow along your pew Bibles, it's on page 1528. Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, and I lay my life down for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father. This is the gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. We'll now join our hymn of the day, hymn 766, The Lord's My Shepherd.
Thank you.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. King David wrote these words, not the younger David. Not the David described in 1 Samuel 16 as the one with ruddy and fine, handsome appearance and features. Not the David of whom the Israeli women sang and danced, Saul has slain his thousands, but David has slain his tens of thousands. David, this young, strong, seemingly invincible, larger-than-life poet, musician, author, harpist, warrior, giant killer, and king. No. The author was the older David, the wiser David, the David seasoned by many dark shadows and a veteran of many deep valleys. Once a fugitive, once an adulterer, once a murderer, once a father grieved by the death of his rebellious son Absalom. This David wrote Psalm 23. The David who experienced pain, loss, failure, grief, depression, and yet amid all this heartache and also learned the comforting reality, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. This is my graduation class of 2008 from Wisconsin Lutheran Seminary. I'm right there. I graduated the seminary in 2008, not as a giant killer, but as a young man in his mid-20s with an undeniable sense of invincibility. I'm graduated, doggone it, and I'm going to be the best pastor. After all, what could go wrong? I was graduated after 9 years of post-high school education. I was married with the best wife ever. She gave me all that power in the world. We were planning on having children, and I was going to serve as a pastor, eventually retire, and you know, as imagined in the fairy tales, I would live happily ever after. Back then, as a seminary graduate, I could have written a sermon on Psalm 23. Using all the resources of the seminary library, all the lexicons, the commentaries, the grammars, I could have accurately described God's good shepherding, the green pastures and the quiet waters of the gospel, the paths of righteousness, the rod and the staff, the overflowing cup and the bountiful table, and of course, dwelling in the house of the Lord forever. The difference is, even just after being out for 13 years, all I really knew was just how to be a student. Just ask Stephanie. She would say that, man, those pastors, they didn't have to grow up till late 20s. She's nodding her head. I merely knew and believed these realities. Now, I'm just starting to begin to understand and experiencing some of them. After experiencing some heartaches, deaths of loved ones, sat at many bedsides of members, counseled through several unwanted divorces, troubled marriages, lived through some financial difficulties, now I am starting to begin to experience and know these realities. I better understand God's good shepherding because I've experienced it not only in good times, but in bad times. Not simply in green pastures, but in deep, dark valleys in which I wondered if even the Good Shepherd himself could deliver me from. But he always did. Always. There's three types of knowledges. There's head knowledge, there's heart knowledge, and there's a hurt knowledge. Head knowledge says, I know. Heart knowledge says, I believe. Hurt knowledge says, at last I understand. And so in life, a deep valley or dark shadow becomes a truer kind of seminary. And it is in our need that we learn to confess, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Period. That's music to a sick man's ears. That's courage to a dying woman's spirit. That's rest to a weary person's soul. That's comfort in hospital rooms and gravesides. I shall not want. These words of David are as fresh and relevant as the day they were written. Not the echo of the distant, dusty past, but the warm words of the living Savior who said, I am the Good Shepherd. The Good Shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. David was the king of Israel. But before he was king, he was a shepherd boy who tended the flocks of his father Jesse. And as a shepherd, David understood the importance of good shepherding, of never forsaking the sheep, of never leaving them, of leading the sheep to green pastures and still, quiet waters, of giving the sheep rest, of keeping the sheep on the paths of righteousness. That is on the right path, of protecting the sheep from predators with his rod and his staff, and of bringing the sheep safely home. Yet, as meaningful as all these activities of shepherding were to David, they were even more meaningful to David as one of the sheep, as one of us, as those described in Isaiah 53, verse 6, we all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way. When David penned the words of Psalm 23, he wasn't simply writing about sheep. He was writing about himself. He was writing about the gracious and faithful way God had shepherded him through every phase of his life. His youth, and as he aged, his good times and his bad times, through all of his successes and through all of his failures, even in health and sickness, at his peaks and even in the valleys. Indeed, many verses of Psalm 23 suggest actual events in David's life. Consider the words of Psalm 23:1, which we've read before. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. For David, this was neither a vain wish nor an empty confession. David lived the reality of these words many times, and certainly when he faced the giant Goliath. Remember that epic battle? Was there even ever a greater mismatch than this young shepherd boy with a slingshot versus a 9-foot-tall giant whose armor alone weighed 125 pounds. And yet, instead of running from the giant, David ran toward Goliath, shouting as he ran, "You come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will hand you over to me, and I'll strike you down and cut off your head." With God on his side, David lacked nothing. David saw no need for fear or surrender. The same David who would write in Psalm 27, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?" And dear friends, Though there are many types of towering giants in this world, marital problems, financial difficulties, loneliness, guilt, depression, anxiety, illness, addictions. Nevertheless, with the Lord as our shepherd, we have no reason to fear or surrender either. Or consider verse 5 of Psalm 23. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. What did David mean with this imagery? Surely he meant more than just sitting down to a fine meal of tomahawk steaks and shish kebabs. The picture is one of victory and inner peace. How could David muster an appetite, much less eat, when surrounded by enemies, unless he were certain of God's presence, God's power, and God's protection? But through faith, he was certain of these realities. And he had every reason for such certainty. For we read in 2 Samuel chapter 8 that the Lord gave David victory wherever he went. Tell me, isn't David's Lord our Lord? And has our Lord changed in any way? Has he become smaller, weaker, more limited, less interested? No. God declares, I, the Lord, do not change. And if this is true, why should you and I fear our enemies, whether they go by the name of Philistine or ISIS? Troubled marriage or coronavirus. Like David, we have absolutely no reason to fear and no reason to surrender. Like David, we need not run from our problems, but rather run toward our challenges, shouting a challenge similar to David's, "You come against me, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty." David's life was the context of Psalm 23. But then, our lives also are the context of Psalm 23. Our lives, our hurts, our pains, our disappointments, our losses. And it's the personal nature of Psalm 23, our personal relationship with God and his personal shepherding of us, that moves us to cherish this psalm and to commit it to memory and to flee to his precious promises amid the most difficult and anguishing circumstances of our lives. When we feel lost and alone, when we face illness and death, when we are betrayed by glittering promises of this world, or when we succumb to weakness and temptation, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. How personal is Psalm 23? Personal enough for many personal pronouns. I, me, and my to occur 16 times in just 6 verses. When you read Psalm 23, don't merely think of David. Think of yourself. Insert yourself into this psalm. For this surely is what the Spirit of God wants you to do. Verse 1, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Verse 2, he makes me to lie down. He leads me. Verse 3, he restores my soul. He leads me in the paths. Verse 4, though I walk through the valley, I will fear no evil. You are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Verse 5, you prepare a table before me my enemies, my head, my cup. Verse 6, goodness and mercy shall follow me. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. How can we think that God doesn't care about us as individuals, or that God isn't personally involved in our lives, needs, and our problems? How personal was the cross for Jesus? The cross by which he atoned for all of our sins. I am the good shepherd, Jesus said. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. The Greek word that is used for know here is gignosko. And gignosko refers to a personal knowledge, an experiential knowledge, not just merely a head knowledge. And for Jesus, I would hasten that it even goes further to the hurt knowledge of our sins and suffering. As Isaiah wrote, but he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. All our iniquities, all our sins laid on Jesus, our good shepherd. Oh, he knows us fully this way too. The beautiful imagery of Psalm 23 is suggestive of many spiritual blessings in our lives. The green pastures and the still waters remind us of the spiritual nourishment we receive through his word. The restored soul reminds us of the rest and rejuvenation we receive from that same word of God. And how in Jesus Christ we obtain the strength to press on day after day, problem after problem. The paths of righteousness remind us of how God alone leads us in the right paths. Whether the path is on the way to be saved or the way to live. For we would never find the right path or walk on the right path on our own. Walking through the valley of the shadow of death reminds us that our faithful God is always with us, both in the peaks of life and on the valleys of life. But don't take my word for it. Take his. God is the one who states in Hebrews, "Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you." The rod and staff, God's protection and his correction. The table prepared in the presence of his enemies, that inner peace and outer calm that come from knowing that if God is for us, no one and nothing can be against us. The head anointed with oil, how God has chosen us and sets us apart as his very own. As Simon Peter stated in his first letter, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of God who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. The cup that runneth over, the bountiful way in which God blesses us, the goodness and mercy that follow. The only thing that can happen when God is leading the way. And finally, the dwelling in the house of the Lord forever. That is the certain outcome of every Christian's faith and life. In my Father's house are many mansions, Jesus says. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. All of these wonders, wonderful blessings are ours, dear friends. But understand that they only come to us in one way and one source, the Lord. That is why the first verse of Psalm 23 is the most important verse in the entire psalm. And the source of every other verse in that psalm and every other blessing in that psalm. Miss this emphasis, and you'll miss the most glorious, comforting aspect of this cherished psalm. For the Lord is the emphasis throughout Psalm 23. Notice, He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads, He protects, He corrects. He goes before so that goodness and mercy must follow. He anoints, He prepares the bountiful table. That is the way the Lord shepherds. And He shepherds this way because He is the Lord. One of the first songs I ever learned as a child was I Am Jesus' Little Lamb, hymn 342 in our hymnal. I can still remember my Sunday school teacher mouthing the words from the front pew as we as a Sunday school class were singing the words to this song. With an exaggerated tempo, she was singing it. I am Jesus' little lamb, ever glad at heart I am. Yes, we teach these words to our children. But don't ever think that these words are childish. They're not childish. They are the essence of childlike faith. That simple faith which embraces God as the Good Shepherd, who faithfully and compassionately leads us through all the changes and challenges in our lives. Changes in circumstances, changes in health, changes in finances and location, until we dwell at last in the house of the Lord forever. Having the right and true shepherd means everything. And that right shepherd is the Lord Jesus Christ. In Psalm 23, a psalm that describes the way in which God shepherds us through life, God reveals Himself by the name Lord, a name usually placed in all caps. The Hebrew name is Yahweh, or more commonly, Jehovah. Psalm 23:1 is literally, Jehovah is my shepherd. Jehovah is actually a Hebrew verb, and it means, I am. This is the one name of our God, perhaps more than any other name, that emphasizes the lasting, eternal nature of His faithfulness. He is the one and only shepherd who will never forsake us. He is the one and only shepherd who will lead us to green pastures, through deep valleys, to eternal life. He is the one and only shepherd who will remain faithful to us even when we wander away from Him. It is because Jehovah is our shepherd that we confidently can say, I shall not want. Do we fully comprehend what this means? It means that no burden is unbearable. No marriage is irreconcilable. No sin is unforgivable. No godly goal is unattainable. No ministry is undoable if the Lord is our shepherd. Of course, it also means that if anyone or anything else other than the Lord is my shepherd, I cannot make such a claim. This is my insurance policy, I shall not want. This is my stock portfolio, I shall not want. This is the sum total of all my human righteousness, I shall not want. Foolishness. I can think of no more fitting a summary to a sermon on Psalm 23 than the words of the hymn I learned so long ago. I am Jesus' little lamb, ever glad at heart I am. For my shepherd gently guides me, knows my needs, and well provides me, loves me every day the same. even calls me by my name. Amen. Please stand. The peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. The Lord be with you. Amen. We'll remain standing for our next hymn, I Am Jesus' Little Lamb, hymn 432. This time I invite you to please send in any prayer requests that you may have. There you can text them to my number, 806-773-0516, and please mark them if they're public or private. You may also at this time send in your offerings digitally through Venmo. If you brought your offering here, there's the offering plate there in the back on the way out. You have a couple minutes to send in. Please stand for prayer. We have several prayer requests that came in that we'll include in our prayer here in just a few moments. David Patton had a procedure on Thursday, and they found a nodule on his lung, and he's asking that God obviously heal this and all its effects that it's causing. Kim Patton had knee replacement surgery on one of his knees on Friday. He's still in the hospital, but is hoping to return today. He had some reaction to the anesthesia that they gave him, so they're working on that, and hopefully that they can send him home with some of the medical equipment that he needs today. Amarillo, they have called Alan Kirschbaum a couple weeks ago, and he is nearing the end of trying to decide if he's going to come or not, and so we keep him in our prayers, as we would love to see him here. I think he'd be a great fit, so we keep him in our prayers and the group up in Amarillo. And then Pastor Andy Martins, the father of Peter Martins, Peter was up there visiting him this week, and they're still developing a treatment plan for the cancer that they found in his leg. Is it right or left leg? His left leg. And so there's some difficulties with that, and so hopefully they can find it and develop a good plan, and that God's plan will work out for the best. Let us go to the Lord in prayer as we begin with the opening song responses.
In the morning, O Lord, I call to you. Be merciful to me and hear my prayer.
As they had a procedure on Thursday on him, and they found the nodule on his lung. And dear Lord, we ask you to heal David. All the effects that it's causing him, may you watch over him, care for him, and bring him to healing if it's your will, dear Lord. We also ask you to please be with David's father, Kim, as he had knee surgery on Friday, and now is recovering in the hospital. We ask you to please bring him home soon so that he can recover at home and more in the comfort with his family. Heal him soon so that he can get back up and doing the things that he loves to do. Dear Lord, we ask you to please be with Alan Kirschbaum as he deliberates on coming here to Amarillo or staying and serving there in Caledonia, Michigan, or also the other call that he has to West Bend, Wisconsin. Dear Lord, please be with him during this time as he holds those calls. Guide him in the way you want him to be and serving in your kingdom. And we ask you to please be with the Amarillo Core Group up there. Bless them as they worship together, as they're gathered together today, live streaming. May they continue to grow as a group and in faith in you. And finally, dear Lord, we ask you to please be with your servant, Andy Martins. As the troubling news of receiving cancer not too long ago has struck, and dear Lord, we know that that's difficult news to swallow. But dear Lord, we ask you to please be with Andy and remind him that you are his shepherd, that you are watching over him, carrying him through this burden of life. This is not the end. Lord, we know that you are watching over him and that you have a plan for him and will carry him through to the plan that you have laid out for him. Please be with the doctors and the nurses as they provide the care, and may it lead to health here on this earth or care with you for eternity in heaven. Hear us, Lord, as we bring you now our private petition. We now join the prayer that you yourself have taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
O Lord, our Heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, you have brought us safely to this new day. Defend us with your mighty power and grant that this day we neither fall into sin nor run into any kind of danger. And in all we do, direct us to what is right in your sight, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord.
Let us praise the Lord. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
You may be seated for our closing hymn, hymn 141, At the Lamb's High Feast, we sing. Pleasure to worship with you this morning on this festival of the Good Shepherd Sunday. I have a couple announcements for you. There you see my email. If you do not receive my email, please let me know, and we'll make sure that we can get that to you so you can stay in touch. This week will be outreach meeting on Wednesday night. Stay tuned for that. Brad, our chairman, will contact you and let you know for sure if we're meeting this week or if it'll be May. We'll decide what for sure we're going to do for the planning of the summer events. Notice the first bullet point there, there's a furnace thermometer. If you remember back to the congregational meeting, we said we're going to try to raise our goal of $10,000 to replace the whole furnace for the fellowship hall before our next budget kicks in, which is September 1. So the goal would be to get to $10,000 by September 1, and then it doesn't have to be in the budget. So this would be above and beyond offerings. And so far, we've already gotten $2,780. And so you'll see in the entryway, there's a thermometer hanging with the red filling up. And so that will gauge how far and where we're getting on that goal. And so right now, like I said, we're at $2,780. So we're close to a third, a little bit more than 25%. We're continuing our Bible study on Sunday mornings there in the fellowship hall at 9:15 on Sunday mornings. We are studying right now the part where Jesus is reaching out to Nicodemus. And we'll probably start into and get into the next lesson this coming Sunday as well, which is Jesus and the Samaritan woman at the well. So I hope you can join us anytime. It's easy to jump in and join us live or even on the live stream. It's live there too. Those are all the announcements that I have. May the Lord bless your day and your week.